The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords supreme, through all eternity.
Should I have been at work?
They talked about you when you had your children.
when you fail. You don't have to do anything for anyone to talk about you. And if you are given a little bit of a position, and you want to be talked about, I give you Donald Trump as a person. All you have to do is say something controversial. Do something controversial, and people will talk about you. And but you know, Jesus, they were talking about Jesus. No, you don't understand. They were talking about him in the village. They were talking about him in the towns. They were talking about him in the cities. They were talking about Jesus in the world, in the known world. In the palace, they were talking about him. In the local fisherman's bar, they were talking about him. Even the emperor was talking about Jesus. Everyone was talking about him, the things that he said, and the things that he did. Who is Jesus? They're talking about him. You see, the leaders, the Jewish religious leaders, they were asking Jesus to reveal himself. Reveal yourself. Unbeknownst to you, when Jesus reveals himself to a person or to a group of people, he reveals it with a purpose. He reveals it with a purpose that you and I, once that revelation has become clear, that we will, in that, recognize our own purpose. Jesus reveals himself for a purpose. And it is that you and I, when we realize who Jesus is, that we would grab that, we would run with it, and we would start to talk about Jesus. We would tell the mothers about Jesus. We would tell the fathers about Jesus. We would tell the police officers about Jesus. We would tell the politicians about Jesus. We would tell the beggars about Jesus. And we would tell the king and queens about Jesus. Everyone has got to hear about Jesus. They wanted to know who are you. Jesus said, look, I have told you. I have told you who I am. But you know that there are people who ask questions of Jesus or about Jesus, but they don't want to know the answer. Who is he? I've told you. You can send them a fax. You can send them a WhatsApp. You can send them a Bible. You can send them a Facebook. You can send them a Twitter. You can send them an Instagram. You can send them a pigeon. You can stand in front of them and tell them about Jesus, and they will still say, he is a good man. Anyone who says that Jesus is a good man cease to come at a place where they will intellectually process Jesus. Jesus cannot be intellectualized. Jesus is not a good man. Because if you believe that Jesus is a good man, you will deal with a good man. And then you have the religious leaders who are kind of saying to him, tell us who you are. And in the midst of the crowd, you have the level of the authority. If Jesus says, I am the Messiah, they will arrest him there and then. His time had not yet come. And no one was going to rush it. That's why Jesus said to them, I have told you, if you had ears to hear, you would hear. I said, some believed and some didn't. And those who believed would fall away. And all that would be left would be the position of the religious leader. He said, I am the good shepherd. All that came before me, if you listen to what I am saying, I am the good shepherd. All those who came before me are thieves and robbers. Jesus understood that those that were listening to him would also understand that within the context of a village, the shepherds would all come and they would bring their sheep and it would be in the pen. And round about dawn each morning, the shepherds would come and they would call to their sheep. Anyone who turned up before dawn is a thief and a robber. They're not coming through the gate. And they would stand and they would make a call, or they call to their sheep. And their sheep would hear that unique voice of their shepherd. And the sheep would come. The religious leaders standing there who considered themselves to be the shepherd of Israel was now hearing one much greater than them, declaring, I am the true, the good shepherd. Tell us. Everyone is talking about Jesus. He knows that they're talking about him. If this is the Messiah, if this is the Son of God, then the religious leaders of the time have got to reconcile the fact that for 30 years, the Messiah has been in their midst. For 30 years, they claim to be the people that God spoke through. But yet, Jesus walked amongst them. Jesus taught and ate amongst them, and they didn't know it. Is it possible? Is it possible that Jesus could walk amongst us? Is it possible that Jesus could be in that very same environment that you and I are at, and yet we don't know? We don't know. Jesus knew. He knew that people were talking about him. Because it's the conclusion that we come to. It's a time when we say, Jesus is not the prophet. Jesus is not Jeremiah. Jesus is not Elijah. Jesus is Jesus, the Son of God.
Hallelujah.
He's no one else. They asked the same question of John the Baptist. A man who didn't know miracles, but yet they inquired of him. Was he the Messiah? And there in their midst, Jesus knew that people was talking about him. Or wouldn't it be good when you walked into a shop and you're in the line at the supermarket that you hear the person in front of you say, isn't God good? Isn't the Lord amazing? And as you're walking out the supermarket and you see the security guard there, you say to him, good evening, and he said, may God bless you. Isn't my Lord amazing? And then you get on a bus and you can't find your oyster, and you say to them, I can't, he said, the Lord has paid the price, my brother. Wouldn't it be amazing?
Yeah.
That by the way, I'm going out about and we pass the playground and we're hearing the children talking about the Lord God Almighty. Everybody's talking about Jesus. You walk in the house, the FA Cup's on, and God says, no, I'm going to talk about my brother. I'm going to talk about Jesus. should be Jesus.
Yes.
And that should be the thing that sets our heart on fire. Yes. Just the topic about his goodness. Who saved man that I am? Yes. Jesus asked yes. his disciples. Because
yeah.
he knew. He knew they were having the conversation. And he knew that the conclusion was important. The conversation can be had. It is the conclusion, my brothers and my sisters, that we come to. And if those religious leaders had come to the conclusion that Jesus Christ is Lord, that Jesus Christ was the Messiah, that Jesus Christ is walking, that God had come down from heaven and was now residing on earth, that revelation would transform their lives. That revelation would transform their thinking. That revelation would reposition them from wherever they thought they were going. They would be on that narrow road to glory.
Hallelujah.
Who saves man that I am? Peter returns and he says, you're the Messiah, the Son of the God. You are the Messiah. The long-awaited one. That's who you are. It was okay for the world and the people of the world to be ambiguous when it comes to the identity of Jesus Christ. They would continue to have that conversation. But those who are following me, those who are following me, those who are my disciples, there is no room for ambiguity in yours and my understanding of who Jesus is.
Hallelujah.
Anyone who asks us, we need to be able to look at them straight in the face and say, Jesus, like Peter, he is the Messiah, the Son of the living God, the long-awaited one. We need to tell them that salvation comes from no other, because there's no other name that has been given unto man by which they can be saved other than the precious name of Jesus. We need to talk about Jesus more and more. We need to be an example in our household. See, we come to church and we hear a sermon, and we come to church and we do an excellent Bible study and we read about the things that Jesus said. And we read about the things that he did. And we've heard it so many times. It seems to have lost its power. It seems to have lost its weight. Travel with me, if you will. Travel with me, if you will. That there is a woman in a crowd, and Jesus is pushed from every corner. And all of a sudden, Jesus mentions, who touched me? And his disciples said, that's ridiculous. Everyone's touching you. And he says, no. I felt virtue. Believe me. Somebody's faith touched me. And then the woman comes up and says, it's me. And she explains that she's been suffering from this ailment for years. But she has received her healing. And Jesus declares that. On your way home, who are you talking about? You're talking about Jesus. As you stop for that pint of milk, you're telling somebody about this miracle that has taken place. You're telling somebody about Jesus. The fact that he didn't even touch the woman. You don't believe me. You don't understand. All she did was to touch the hem of his garment. And he wished. I wonder if he did it for her. Could he do it for me? We're talking about Jesus. You're telling your neighbor. Even though he wasn't there. You're telling them, because it's not a story. It's the reality of what our Lord and Savior does on a daily basis. You are standing with me at the tomb of Lazarus. And Jesus stands there, and you hear him. He lifts up a prayer to his father. He says, you know what? I know you're always listening to me. I'm actually praying this prayer for the benefit of those that are around me. And then he steps back. And you're close, you can see it. You're in anticipation. And he shouts out, Lazarus, come forth. For a moment, you're there. For a moment, you don't know whether he's a madman or whether he's demon-possessed. For a moment, you don't know whether he has authority or whether he has lost his mind. There is silence. The stone rolls back, and Lazarus steps forth. Are you here?
Yeah.
Are you seeing?
Yeah.
He walks out. That which was dead is now alive. When he declares, I am the resurrection and the life. What are you doing? You are talking about Jesus. You're talking about the fact this has never been done in my manner. This has never been done in this city. This has never been done. This has never been done. He speaks with authority. He speaks with power. He says it and it is. I'm telling somebody, come on. I want somebody to tell. I'm telling them that's good. I'm pulling up a stranger and saying, you don't understand what I have seen. Man's greatest fear has been overcome. Let's talk about Jesus. Let's tell people about the power of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Let's tell everybody, anyone that would listen about the power and authority of Jesus. There are those of us, those that are under the sound of my voice, that just the name of Jesus gets you excited. Were you here last Sunday?
Nah.
Did you see what I saw? Did you see people standing here talking about the fact that Jesus still heals? Did you hear the testimonies that the Lord God Almighty still hears prayers? Did you see and hear that God still delivers? I wonder how many of us ran home and told somebody about that. I wonder. There are the people of the world and the people of the world. They need to hear our stories. They need to hear our testimonies. They need to hear the conversation. It starts something like this. This was my situation. And then, Jesus. They need to know that whatever it is, there's no finality in Jesus. He can take it and he can turn it around. He can take that which was broken and he can make it whole again. Let's talk about Jesus to anyone that will listen. And this one, even if they don't want to listen, talk about Jesus. There's something remarkable according to the Word of God when you and I speak about Jesus to somebody. The Word of God says, that which you have spoken will not return void. It goes out and it does something in the hearts of those who are hearing. Faith comes by hearing of the word. You've got to talk about Jesus. Be excited. Let the passion flow. Let people know that there is no other God than him. Let them know that they may have heard that he was on the cross and he may have been crucified, but my Lord lives. to them an amazing thing. He says, I've told you, but you don't believe me. Here's the thing. If I don't do the things that my Father has sent me to do, don't believe me. When I read that, I felt condemned. If I don't do the things that I've been sent here to do, if I don't do the things that come out of my mouth, if I don't support the rhetoric with action, don't believe me. I wonder how many of us could stand with a degree of confidence and utter those words to those who know us. How many mothers could stand and fathers stand in front of their children and say, if you don't see me living the life and behaving as the parents that I am supposed to be according to the word of God, don't believe anything I tell you. We have young people. We have a pattern that young people, they are on fire for the Lord. And something along the way, somewhere along the way, we turn around and they're not there. And I wonder how much of that is because what they hear and what they see are not in sync. There is no greater injustice, moms and dads, for our children to see is when we come in here, we put a sense of holiness that is not at home. There's a piety that exists within the prayer meeting and when we come into the church, but when we're at home, it cannot be found. That we use our Christianity as if it's a hat. We wear it on a Wednesday. We wear it on a Sunday. We wear it at a Bible studies. Whenever we come into the gathering of other Christians, this persona, you know, it's in the Superman thing. All of a sudden, he's one thing. And then there is a danger, somehow a different persona. When our children see that, how can you talk to them about Jesus? Jesus loves you. Our behavior and what we see. I was schooled in a Roman Catholic school. And as an 8-year-old boy, I grew up understanding that nuns were supposed to be something else. The behavior of the nuns in the school that I was in freaked me out. Bride of Christ, bride of something else. It freaked me out. Because what I understood them to be and what they represented and how they treated the children were miles apart. There's got to be a consistency. If we are going to talk about Jesus, we better be sure that we can behave a little bit like God. God equips you and I. He calls you and I. He doesn't call you so that you can be like Reverend Williams. He doesn't call you so you can be like my anointed brother there. He does. Do me a favor. Look at the person next to you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. In the same way, in the same authority, in the same sense of expectation. Be like God. Is that too much? Be like God and get involved in stuff. Be like God. Paul said, follow me.
Yeah.
He didn't say be like me. He didn't say that. He said, follow me as I follow. So, Eustace's his interpretation. Be like God as you see me being like God. And if we can't be wise, oh Lord, I'm going to get shot. Wise, be like God to your husbands. Husbands, be like God with your wives. You know, as I was getting to grips with becoming a Christian and listening to my children, the one thing I've done pretty much, from bus driving in church to ushering to a little time with the musicians to PA, what's it, to a little bit more. I kind of, so whenever something needed to be done, I would get a phone call. And do you know what my children said to me at one time, maybe on more than one occasion? You seem to respond to a call from people from church quicker than you respond to something from us. Am I the only one that's ever been?
Yeah.
So I'm being like God with my Christian brothers and sisters, but I'm not being like God with my children. Wives, if you would not say it in front of church, in front of your pastor, in front of your bishop, to your husband, don't say it in private. Be like God. Husbands, if you will not say it in front of a church, if you will not say it in front of an open congregation, don't say it in private to your wives. You are not being like God. Talk about how can I shout at you? How can I disrespect you? How can I say this to you? How can I not support you and then turn around and say to you, Jesus loves you? Be like God. Get involved in the lives of those that are in our community, in the lives of those who are in our church, in our family. Let's get involved. But not as yourself. When you and I try to do something in our own authority, or in our own strength, we bring to that attempt our weaknesses. And we bring our faults. And we bring all of our shortfalls. But when I can say, Lord, I am weak, but you are strong. When I know that I can call upon the name of the Lord, and that is what the world and the people of the world need to hear, and they need to understand, is that there is a God that they can call upon, and that the word of God has declared that if they call on him, he will respond. I was being told last week by a friend of mine. He said a really strange thing happened. He said he had a gas fitter come into his house. And the gas fitter said to him, what do you do for a living? And he said, I'm a street pastor coordinator. And he went on to explain to him that's an activity of the church and all that meant. And he said, to my amazement, just that little sentence turned out to be an hour conversation about faith. He said, I was telling him about Jesus, and he was telling me about his experience, and it concluded with him saying, well, I'm not too sure about this person, Jesus. I think he was a good man. If you believe that Jesus is a good man, you can take that belief to hell with you. You pay Jesus no compliments by saying he's a good man. And you do yourself an injustice. You condemn yourself by the demoting him. Because that's exactly what's been done. My friend turned to this engineer and said, there is nothing that I can say to you in my own might or my own knowledge that will convince you that Jesus Christ is who I have told you he is. But here's what you can do. In the silence of your own room, I want you just to do this. Say, Lord, if you are real, make yourself known to me. You know what the guy said? And the reason he went poor is that the Lord may reveal himself. And when he reveals himself, it will demand change. And when change comes, people respond to change in the way that they should. But never will he be able to stand before the throne of glory and say that he didn't hear. Never will he be able to stand before the throne of glory and say he wasn't given a choice. He can never say that somebody didn't talk to him about Jesus. We need to talk about Jesus. Come on. Shall we talk about the fact that he says that, you know what, I am the gate. Shall we talk about that?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. That there is, this is the most controversial conversation you and I will ever have with those that are not in the faith. The fact that you and I will stand and we will listen and we will say, but the word of God says that no one comes to the Father except by me. No one. There is no compromise on this one. It doesn't matter how politically correct your workplace is. There is no compromise on this one. It doesn't matter whether or not, you know what, he or she is your best gay friend. I don't care. There is no compromise on this one. It doesn't matter what they say in your workplace or what they say in society. I don't care whether you work for the local authorities. I don't care. Because there's no compromise on this one. Any other gospel that is communicated to an inquiring mind, an inquiring heart, any false hope that is given by a child of Christ to someone else that leads them to not believe that there is another way, you condemn them. I condemn them. We condemn them. Outside of Jesus Christ, there is no other way to get to the Father. He is the gate. And unless we know Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, and how do people get to know about Jesus? I don't know. Maybe they can come to church. How do people get to know about Jesus? I don't know. Maybe they'll see a documentary on TV. How do people get to know about Jesus? I don't know. Maybe the school teacher will do it. I don't know. Maybe when they come, the pastor will do it. Here's an idea. Maybe the evangelist will go out there. Maybe the evangelist will go and tell them about Jesus. And when the evangelist brings them in, it is then, of course, that we will worship with them and we will take them for the discipleship class and it is them that we will lift up holy hands and we will welcome them. It is them that we will give them the right hand of fellowship. It is them that we will see them baptized. It is them that we will see them take membership. And it's them.
He responds
each and every one of us. We are either the religious leaders who have a persona of belief, but really just holding on to our status, or are we those people when others were saying he's demon possessed, he's a false prophet? Are we saying, no, I believe? I believe. I believe. Know the truth. And the truth shall set you free. It doesn't say rationalize the truth. It doesn't say intellectually, you know, be able to put it in its caveat. There is this point of knowing. There is this point of knowing when you know. You know, no one can tell you. You just know. And if I have to explain it to you, I can't find the words. The words will let me down. But I know. Is Jesus Christ the Son of God? Is he the Father, the Holy Spirit? Are they one? Yes. How do you know? I know. And it's not because I can give you the A to Z of the whole thing that rationalizes it. I know the truth, and the truth has set me free. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
The world needs to be set free, my brothers, my sisters, my friend. They are captives. And let's be like God. Let's stand. And let's stand and declare that the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me. Come on. Let's be. Let's be more than we understand that we can be. And you don't have to write the script. You just need to tell them your story. Tell them about Jesus. Tell them about how you love him. Tell them about how he loves you. Tell them what the Bible says. You may not know. If you are here today and you don't know this simple truth that the Bible declares that God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. The world needs to know that God's Son did not come to condemn the world, but that through him that may be saved. They need to hear. Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of the living God. There's none like him, there's none before him, and there's none that's going to come after him. He came, he lived, he died, he's resurrected, he's gone and sitting on the right hand of the Father, and he will be back again. The world has got to know. They've got to hear. And they will hear when we start to talk about Jesus. If you are here today, this is my begging bit. It's a rainy day out there. Did any of you wake up this morning, looked out the window and thought, my gosh, if it wasn't Sunday, I'd stay home and do some Saturday show? If it wasn't for the love of God, yeah, and the fact that, you know, if you wasn't there, somebody said, where's sister, blah, 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 that you came to church today, because you know that there was somewhere else you could have been this morning. And that is you and I, the people that already know Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. I'm talking to anyone that, you know, you're coming in, you haven't made the decision. You're still at the place where you're asking yourself, who is this Jesus? Let there be no ambiguity this morning. When I say to you that Jesus is your Savior, he came and he died for you alone. And he'll, you know what, if he needed to, he'll do it again, but he doesn't need to. For salvation is available to you. So if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, Will you say yes to him today? Please, don't leave here. Don't leave here even believing that you have another day in order to make that final decision, that most important decision. If you are here, I beg you, do not leave here. You are here, you left your home, you came in the rain, you got wet, you took your car, you came by bus, you came by train. It is because the Lord God Almighty needed you in this house today. He needed you to be positioned in a place where you can make a choice for Him. So if you do not know Jesus Christ, and you say, Reverend, will you just pray for us? Will you pray for me? Please, let me see your hand. Come. The altar is open. Give Jesus the glory that is due to His name. There needs to be more people that's going to talk about Jesus. You need to hear. If that is you, the altar is open. Can I speak to my brothers and my sisters? If you know Jesus Christ as Lord of your life, say hallelujah. If you would like to be a bit more like God, let me hear you say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Will you stand? Say that the altar is still open. Talk to every child, every woman, every man. The altar is still open to you. Lord, that you would use us to bring change to bring transformation. Lord, that there would be a passion of fire in our spirit, a desire just to tell somebody about you. Challenge our stories, oh God. Stir our faith, oh my Lord and my God. Give us boldness, oh God. And give us a true desire to see Jesus in the lives of others. Make us, form us into better parents, better husbands, better wives, better children. That the world may experience you, all of you, through us, in Jesus' name.